job fair. And I went to a job fair, and I remember being really interested. Like, there's these amazing job fairs. Like, you hand out your CV or your resume. And at that time, like, having just graduated from college, there was, like, nothing on your resume. And so walking around and talking to people about, like being an engineer at NASA and, you know, all kinds of interesting jobs. And there's one about a bank. And one of the things I did that I thought was really great is I decided to just temp a job. So you can do these temp jobs where you get paid as, like, a contractor. Essentially, to come in and get the bottom-level job, like just typing or just, like, taking notes, answering phones. But you can do it in any industry. So you can do it in a bank. You can do it in a law firm. You can do it in, you know, in a company of sorts. Like, you can do it all over the place. And it's a great way to get experience. So I ended up deciding, I got an offer to go and be a temp for a month at a bank. And I did it just because my mom thought it was a good idea. And so sometimes it's worth listening to your parents. So I did that, and I decided at the end of the month that it was horrible. I would never, ever, in any way, work in a bank. But at the same time, the woman who was in charge of hiring people, she told me that she had a client who was interested in hiring a young person with a biology background, and they wanted to know if I would take the job interview. And so the only reason I took the job interview was because it was in New York and I wanted the frequent flyer miles. I had absolutely no interest. I said I would never take this job. Like, there's no interest, but like 5,000 free miles is awesome, and one free night in a hotel, like, it didn't get better than that. So I was really excited. So I went and I did that job interview, and lo and behold, they offered me a job. And I was so shocked. I was like, these people must be so desperate. Like, I have no qualifications. Why are they offering me this job? And I originally said no, and then a couple weeks later, I changed my mind. I said yes. But it turned out it was this amazing job where it's like one of the wealthiest families in Europe. They control, like, they literally own Sweden. And they control, it's the Wallenberg family. And I had suddenly this job where, like, I was 23 years old and I was responsible for, like, hundreds of millions of dollars in deciding where to put this money into investments. So the moral of the story is, like, in some ways, you have no idea what are the opportunities that are going to come your way and exactly what you're going to do. And I always thought I was going to be a doctor. And in some ways, like, it was a series of events. Like, I always think back to, like, my entire life is dictated by the fact that I went to this stupid job fair that my mom made me go to. And in some ways, like, being open-minded, like, you guys are in this amazing position in life where, like, everything is before you. And the more opportunities you let yourself be exposed to, the more you're just going to enrich your life. And just, like, ever saying no to, like, oh, no, I don't want to do that, or that doesn't sound interesting, like, you guys are young. Like, you have, everything should be interesting to you. Just do everything, because, like, by the time you're 40, I'm 43 now, like, you start to kind of get it, like, people get narrower and narrower and narrower, but at that point in your life, in your 20s, like, teens and 20s, like, everything is new, and every experience will add up to something. And so I look back on every single job and everything I've ever done and how that's, like, added up to, like, what I'm doing today. So one of the things that was amazing for me is in 19, I happened to take this, I deferred college for a year, and when I lived in San Diego, and I happened to take this class about sequencing the human genome. And I knew nothing about genetics, nothing about it. And I remember them, like, this talk, I still have the talk of, like, or this, it was a one unit course about, like, what was gonna happen with the genome. And I was so interested in this talk. And then when I started working on Wall Street, when I took that job that I didn't want to take, but I took the job, and I realized the human genome was about to be sequenced. And this all happened in, like, 98, 99, 2000, where these papers came out, and it was, like, amazing. Everyone was talking about, like, the human genome, like, we finally know the code within the humans. And then they kind of realized, like, damn, like, we know this code, and we have no idea what it means. And 3 billion base pairs is incredibly complicated and incredibly hard. So there was all this momentum to, like, try to figure out, like, just set aside the code. And then once we got the code, we realized, like, it's gonna take years and years and years and years to figure out what it means. And that's kind of when I realized, I was like, this is so interesting, because scientific discovery, like, there's this beauty of scientific discovery where, like, you get a result But like the results are so interesting in knowing what the discoveries are from like understanding what these 3 billion base pairs are is so interesting. So I kind of knew at that point in time, like the genetics are, you know, it's like it's we live in Silicon Valley and we're all about computer programming, but like your computer code is your genome. And we see, like, look around this room and all the diversity in this room. And like, and it's all from like small changes in your genetic code. And like humanity, as much as you guys might think that you guys are similar or different, like there's this amazing long tail of diversity. And being able to understand like these little changes in your DNA and how those come out is just spectacular. So this was in 2007, they kind of showed, these are, each one of those lines is one of your chromosomes. You know, you have 23 pairs of chromosomes. And each one of those dots is sort of like where we found genetic associations. So that was in 2007. That was the state of the research then. And then this is 2017. So you can see like each one of those dots is a discovery and it's so cool. Like you make these discoveries and you suddenly understand really simple things like, very exciting, like earwax type. Like why do some people have wet earwax and some people have dry earwax? And like there's one change in all 3 billion base pairs that caused that. The same thing like with eye color, like there's like one genetic change that causes the majority of blue eyes. Like that's so cool. Like of all those 3 billion base pairs, like the fact that there's like one small change. So those are all the types of discoveries that I've made. And then like one thing that I realized when I also talk to kids is like people don't seem to realize like how much everything around us has DNA and that you're similar to other things. So like in fact, like my daughter loves it. It's like, Chloe, you are 50% like a banana. And you're also kind of similar to a fly. And so, like, you actually share DNA with, like, your dog and with flies and with vegetables. And, like, you actually are related to everything on Earth. And, you know, I was in London once and there was this, you know, they have, like, more of an anti-genetically modified organism. And so there was this whole protest going on where people were saying, I don't want to eat food with DNA. And in some ways, like I launched this when I was like, people don't understand some of the basics. Like there's DNA in everything, people, like eat your rocks. And so just realizing that like you're kind of related. And that's sort of the beauty of genetics is like how you're actually, you're related to all of each other. Like every single person in this room, I can find a common ancestor for you guys. Like everyone, you're all related, and you're also related, unfortunately, to like flies and bananas. So some of the things that are really awesome that we do with genetic information is that you can understand like why do some people get disease and some people don't. Like some people are genetically higher risk for being diabetic, for instance, or some people are genetically higher risk for having, you know, something like Parkinson's disease. And so the beauty for me of genetics was always this idea of genes and environment, that all of you have a genetic code in you. So you know that you have certain kinds of risk. But then there's this whole environmental component. Like you get your genes and you can't change those, but you can change your environment. So like, wow, if I could tell you you could live to 100, but you have to do X, Y, and Z, well then like you might do it because you want to avoid that. So the more we can understand environment, then the better it is. And you look at things like Benadryl, you guys have all probably taken Benadryl in your lifetime. Who gets hyper? Any of you guys get hyper when you take Benadryl? One. So some people get sleepy and some people get hyper. It's the kind of thing, like if I'm on an airplane with my child and I'm giving them Benadryl, I want to know if they're going to be like bouncing off the walls or if they're going to fall asleep, because you kind of want to know that when you are on a long flight. charging, we should all just call up the Rotary Club and like go to Boys and Girls Clubs and other places and actually just sit down and like get people excited about science rather than trying to say like, oh, we the scientists are marching because we're so important. And it was this idea that I feel like everyone could be a scientist. So 23andMe, we started the company, it's 23andMe based on 23 pairs of chromosomes, it's all about you. And with this idea that if we're gonna start to figure out those 3 billion base pairs and what it means, it's the greatest scientific discoveries of our lifetime, let people follow the science in real time. Like let them actually see every time we make a new discovery. Search on your genome. Like there's a paper that comes out, search on it and then see, what does that mean for me? Like you guys are like, you don't pay taxes yet, for some of you. But when you pay the taxes, you're paying for all this research. So you might as well know what it means for you. And so 23andMe was started with this idea that anyone can be a scientist. And it's remarkable how controversial that is. So the company's been around for 11 years. So those of you who are seniors, like back when you were in first grade, we started this. And it was like literally, when we started the company, it was like pitchforks. People hated what we were doing. And we had this launch story where we were on the cover of Style section at the New York Times. And scientists came after me, like, how dare you put something that's scientific in the Style section? And I was like, no, that's the whole point. Like, reach a different audience. Like, why do we need to go after more scientists that read the Tuesday New York Times Science? Like, go to the Style section. Like, that's great. That's a sign of success for us. So we launched the company with this idea, and it was very, very controversial. So it's super simple. The other thing we did is like, it's in a little kit. It's all online. It's at home. Like most time, if you have to get blood, you have to go to the doctor. They draw blood. It's painful. It's not fun. So like, we make it kind of colorful. It's like you spin in a tube. It's all online. People in medicine just can't understand this. Like, what do you mean? Where's the report? I'm like, there's no report. It's called a website. And healthcare is in some ways, as you know, when you go to the doctor, it's so wildly antiquated. Like doctors just can't understand. Like it's a website? What do you mean? What do people do? What do they look at? And you let them share their data? Like it's seen as like so controversial that we actually let people share their data. So we do all kinds of fun things. We return results to you about things like your disease risks, and then fun things like traits like the eye color, your hair color. We do a lot of ancestry stuff, so like we look at all of you and say, where in the world are you from? And so we look at all these populations in Africa and Asia and Europe and the Americas, and then we can tell you like, hey, maybe you're like 20% Irish and 20% Native American and 20% French. Like, so we kind of break it down in that way. And the thing that's fun is that people have this idea of like, oh, I'm just from like one part of the world. And then we can show them like, you're actually really, like you're a citizen of the world. And it's really changed people's perspectives of themselves. The other fun thing is you can actually start to look at how genes are passed down. So this is actually Chloe's eyeball. That's her eyeball. And so one thing that we do is I want to see like, where did her eyeballs come from? So obviously they came from me and her father, but like you're actually just a compilation of your four grandparents, but in different percentages. So her eyeball actually comes from her father's mother and my father. So I can look at that and I can look at, you know, my mother-in-law and my father and look at her eyes and be like, that's what she got those genes associated with eye color from them. So it's really fun to actually, it's like a fun tool, and like we've created all these different ways that people can start to look and see their DNA and like how it's been passed down. So now we're the largest genetic company out there. We have over 2 million people who've done it. Again, it's like seen as super controversial. Like there's so like most of healthcare is not necessarily like optimized for like large volume. It's more optimized for sales. And these are just this is a paper that shows. It's something, again, you guys are really like in, you guys are young and you're living in the information age where you're used to getting all this information. But this is a paper from 1961 that asked doctors if they had a patient who came in with cancer, would they tell the patient that the patient had cancer? So I assume, like, raise your hand. Like, do you assume that, like, if you walked in and you had a cancer diagnosis, would your doctor tell you? Yes. mean, if you have information, if your doctor today can't withhold information from you. Like, if you walked in and you said, like, if you had a definitive diagnosis of something, your doctor would need to tell you.
But what if you're
at risk? So that's different. That's like, so, and that's part of where 23andMe has been more controversial, because if I tell you that you have a risk factor for something, most doctors don't test people for risks, because it's always been seen as like, well, what would you do? And so that's where there's definitely a controversy. But this is for people. This is a paper from 61 that was about, like, you had a definitive cancer diagnosis. And what they found is that over 90% of doctors would not tell the patients they had it. And so there's been like a real change in healthcare, where in the past it was like your doctor in the white coat, they kept all the information from you. Even things like pregnancy, it wasn't seen that like women could rationally ever learn that they were pregnant by themselves. Like, the idea of an at-home pregnancy test was super controversial when it came out. And so, like, all these things, like, healthcare has really evolved, and I actually think it's your generation that's gonna push through this idea of, like, I really want, like, you guys are used to getting real-time information. You're on Facebook and YouTube, like, you see something, you want it to happen right away, you're used to getting it right away. And so, like, healthcare is not that way yet, but it's your generation that's gonna make it that way. So, last, I just put, this is my last slide here, I put this one on here. So 23andMe has been around for 11 years, and we've had all kinds of controversy, including we have what's seen as the meanest letter from the FDA ever, shutting us down. And so it was like, it's the most read, essentially cease and desist letter that they've ever sent out. And so this is me, like, it's a question, and I put this here because it's a question of your attitude about how you approach things. And I saw our controversy always as like a real positive. Like, we are driving real change, and because we're driving real change, we're controversial. And that if you want to do something really significant in the world, and you want to like really push through things, you're going to have big ups and downs. And if you just take it with a positive attitude, it makes a huge difference. So this was me. This was in my Senate hearing, and in my Senate hearing, we're laughing here because I always wear sneakers, and I change my shoes. I had forgotten one of my shoes. So I had to walk into my Senate hearing with one shoe. And you know, and part of it is like, you just have to take an attitude of life. Like, you can't control everything. And you focus on what you believe is like really right for you, and what you believe is the right thing. And you just always have a good attitude about it. And so I was really happy when that article came out, because it was about how like I'd been shut down. I had this horrible warning letter, and like, I was still like happy about it. Like, I was just there to like try to explain what we're doing. And I think it's important to always have, like, the attitude you have is part of what helps you drive some of the changes. So with that, I know that you guys have Q&A. Like, we had one good question in terms of like the stuff. So let you ask questions. Yeah.
So how far back does like the DNA date back from? Because theoretically, everyone came from, well, that's what you say now, like, came from the same place. So how far back?
It becomes like a really interesting and complicated calculation for any two people to be able to go back. But we look back thousands of years, and we can try to date people based on sort of like known regions of your DNA that don't mutate. And we can look at any two people and say like, hey, you two have a common ancestor from, you know, X number of hundreds of years ago. So probably less than 1,000. We always say reliably, we can kind of go back 500 years.
What was the controversial issue?
It was not seen that people could get access to their genetic information without a physician. It was because people believed that your genetic information should go through your doctor. And we sell direct to consumer. Like, we just let you go online. So there's a huge aspect of healthcare where people don't believe that you are capable of handling information about your health by yourself. And they believe that you need a chaperone.
But are they worried about what happens to that information, or just people getting that information?
They were worried about people getting the information. They were worried about, like, if I tell you that you're higher risk for diabetes, like, let's say I tell you that you're lower risk for diabetes, will you go out then and eat donuts all day long? So, like, that's where, like, and we had, like, there's more serious ones, like breast cancer. Will you go and do a mastectomy where you cut off your breasts? Like, will you go and do your own mastectomy? And so we had to explain, like, no one's cutting off their breast with a butter knife. Like, no one's going and so, you know, there was legitimate, and that's part of it. one of the things that's sad is like once, like I'm in, again, I'm in my 40s now and I see all my friends from college. There's nothing worse than like people in their 40s who are like, oh, you know, I never took off time, or I was so driven to just like do this one career, I never got a look around. And I think that, you know, you don't really know what's out there until you try different things. And so it's like, it's the best thing I think you can do is actually really be open-minded to experimenting and trying and like, and not being afraid to quit. Like, it's one thing I realized, like when I had jobs, and once you know you don't really like something, like switch jobs. And like, and one of the most important things I think you need to do is also find, like work at a job where there's a good mentor. Like I'm really lucky that I work for somebody who spends the time teaching me things. And I always like, I always say there's men, there's women, and there's assholes. And you should just work for men and women. And if you find that you work for an asshole, like you move on.